This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We come together to praise our Lord and King, to encourage each other as we seek perfection in love and faith and in righteousness, to comfort each other in our sorrows, to sing and laugh and revel in all the blessings that God lavishes upon us, to seek the face of God. Do have a couple of announcements. Normally on Sundays, we have a luncheon. We will not be having a luncheon this Sunday because I understand that we normally cancel luncheon when it's in competition with a fundraiser over at the Catholic Church, their annual enchilada dinner. So if you're looking for something, if you're expecting something to eat, well, just let's go. How about our brothers over at the Catholic Church and brothers and sisters over there? Also, for the business of the church, annual conference, which was postponed from June, is going to be this Saturday. They're doing it virtually over Zoom, and I will be set up in the fellowship hall for people who would like to see what happens at the denominational level. The church and the business of the church, Methodist Church, is an open records and an open meetings church, and so everyone is welcome to participate. It's from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. I'm going to be there all day. Tina has to be there all day as our delegate, but the rest of you can come and go if you'd like to visit. We might have the people from other churches who don't have the capability to zoom in to the meetings. I told the district superintendent I'd be glad to host, so we might have some visitors here. That's coming this Saturday, too, for the business of the church. Our opening hymn this morning is number 370, Victory in Jesus. Let's stand and sing.
Thank you.
at Psalm 99. The Lord reigns, let the people tremble. The Lord sits enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion, and is exalted among all peoples. Let them praise your great and wondrous name.
Holy is the Lord.
Mighty ruler, lover of justice, you have established equality. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Extol the Lord our God. Worship at the Lord's footstool.
Holy is the Lord.
Bless the name. Read it. Here is good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
As forgiven and reconciled people, let us greet each other with signs of reconciliation and peace. Socially distanced. Our hymn of preparation is on the screen. Let's all stand and sing. Well, you know, if that bush catches on fire, maybe you better not put it out because it's trying to get close to God. But what's going to tell the kids about it was why Moses was told to take off his shoes. Why he was told to take off his shoes? Well, sometimes, why do our parents tell us to take off our shoes when we come into the house? Because they're dirty. We walk around and collect all the dust and the dirt from outside and the mud. And when we come into the house, we take off our shoes to keep the house clean. And so we were trying, with Moses being told he's wearing these sandals, he's walked around in them all day, it's time that when you step onto holy ground to come with clean feet, to come with clean hearts, to come with clean souls. when you're standing on holy ground. Sign of respect in some countries that you always take off your shoes before you enter a house. And so what God is telling Moses is to come clean, to come pure, to come holy into the holy place. The other thing about standing on holy ground in bare feet is that you are in contact with that which is holy. You've come to touch it, to be in the presence of God. And so when Moses is told to take off his shoes, he's in contact with that holy ground, that ground that God has sanctified for him to speak and bring that message of freedom that he brought to Moses and to give him that mission that he was assigned to do. So let's pray. Almighty God, cleanse us so that we may come before you pure and holy, so that we may come before you clean from the messiness of our lives and the messiness of this world. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who cleanses us so that we may be in your presence. Amen. Now, the songs I've been doing, sometimes, you know, we use music to teach our children. And some of the things that we need to teach our children are rather mundane, like how to count. Pretty simple, how to count. And so we sometimes use songs to do, like the alphabet, we teach them the alphabet. These are things that really are just kind of necessary for civilization and necessary for their education, necessary things they're going to need all their life. Well, there's nothing wrong with taking a lesson that we need to teach them anyway and adding into it something about God, or something about the faith, or something about Scripture. The song today is Children Go Where I Send Thee. And it's a song that basically just teaches how to count to 12. And there's lots of variations on this, but that's really all the purpose the song is going to do. But what it does, it uses biblical stories and biblical ideas, and so as they're learning how to do the simple thing of counting, there's also that lesson that we can use, those teachable moments, those opportunities that we have, that in something, that when we're trying to do one thing, we can also slip in the Word of God. Children, go where I send thee. Oh, how shall I send thee? I'm going to send thee one by one, one for the little bitty baby who was born in Bethlehem. Go where I send thee, oh, how shall I send thee? I'm going to send thee two by two, two for Paul and Silas, one for the little bitty baby who was born in Bethlehem. Children, go where I send thee, oh, how shall I send thee? I'm going to send thee three by three, three for the Hebrew children, two for Paul and Silas, one for the little bitty baby who was born in Bethlehem. Now, obviously, this can get very tedious. Oh, you're all 12. The recording I like of it, the record I like of it, is by Peter, Paul, and Mary, where they throw in variations, of course, the harmonies that they have in there. But it ends on 12, so I'm just going to go from, like, 12 minutes per song. I'm going to go from 12 all the way down, but...
Children, go where I send thee. Oh, how shall I send thee? I'm going to send thee 12 by 12, 12 for the 12 disciples, 11 for Elijah taken to heaven, 10 for the 10 commandments, 9 for all the prophets, 8 for Easter morning, 7 for the rest of Sabbath, 6 for the days of creation, 5 for the loaves and fishes, 4 for the gospel writers, 3 for children, 2 for Paul and Silas, 1 for the little bitty baby who was born of the Virgin, laid in a manger, stabbed in heaven, sung by an angel, born in Bethlehem.
I'm not as good as Peter, Paul, Mary, by the way. We come to that time where we return some of those resources that God has entrusted to us, that they may be used to build the kingdom of God, that they may be used to service in ministry. This week, Friday, we had an opportunity to feed the football team lunch before they went on to their game on Friday night. That's this part of reaching out and ministering to our community and reaching out and supporting our community. through our faith and through the mission of the church. Let us pray. Almighty God, giver of all good and perfect gifts, we thank you for the blessing upon blessing you lavish so generously upon us. Give us generous hearts, that the resources you've given us may be used to build your kingdom upon this earth. Amen.
Praise Him, praise Him.
Yesterday there was an event in the Minnesota Alliance held a prayer rally in the city park. It was Tina's idea to get us all involved, and it was a great event. And Meredith was there, and she shared with us her talent. She led us in the national anthem, and we really appreciate the blessing that she has. We also like to thank Robin for playing this morning as I believe Melody has some procedure that she's undergoing, so we will pray for her later on. So in this series that we're going, we have the Gospels and the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Matthew and John were actual apostles of Jesus Christ. They were actually part of that 12. Now, John was chosen slightly before the call of Matthew, but both were selected out of the disciples to be those apostles, to be those special 12. And so for side by side, for 3 years, they were in this class together. They were in the studying under Jesus to be their disciples. And if you look at the gospel stories of Matthew and John, they're very, very different. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are very similar, but John is very different. Matthew is very concerned about what Jesus did. He's a Levite. He is trained in the Torah. The Levites were the tribe that were kind of the keepers of the faith of the 12 tribes of Israel. The priests were from the tribe of Levi. And so for Matthew, explaining the faith, defending the faith, expounding on the faith was very important to him. So Matthew's gospel is very much concerned with showing that Jesus is the promised Messiah, that God's law, prophecies are being fulfilled in the coming of Jesus Christ. And he shows very much the who, what, when, where, and how of Jesus' life as he reports the Gospels. Now, John, he has a different concern. He's concerned with what it means. He wants to know the why, and wants you to know the why. And so, what does it mean for Jesus to be the Messiah? Now, by the time that John has written his Gospel, which is about 30 years after the other Gospels were written, he knew about the other three Gospels. He'd read them. He was familiar with them. They were already being circulated throughout the world, or the Roman world, as part of this Christian movement. And he reads them, and he kind of, when he writes, he really doesn't feel he needs to repeat the events that were already described in the other three Gospels. There are other stories that are important to him. So, you know, if you want to know some of the story, you know, read Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Here are some other stories and some other teachings, and they explain, and John is very clear. He wants you to know that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and he's the Savior. For example, the other three Gospels report the Last Supper. That moment where Jesus takes the bread and the cup and passes them out and sets them. Next week is going to be our communion Sunday, and we will have the one loaf, the one cup. We're going to return to that. Now, we will have the individual cups for those who are more comfortable taking communion that way, but there's also will be offered again the one cup and the one loaf. But John doesn't record that incident. He doesn't record the institution of the Eucharist. John thinks, well, you already got that story. You already know it from the other Gospels. John records, however, the washing of the feet, something that the others do not. So it's John is kind of a supplement to what's already covered in the other Gospels. Now, Matthew is the oldest, tradition says he's the oldest disciple. He's about 35. He's even older than Jesus. John, on the other hand, is the youngest. He's about 14. And you have this wide variety in the ages of the disciples. And they're in a society, both the Jewish society and the Greco-Roman society, are ones that put a high emphasis on age. Age is to be respected. Age is to be honored. There's the idea that age brings wisdom, and so you need to respect that wisdom of the people who are older than you. And here's John, he's about half the age of several of the disciples. Now, the disciples are generally on the younger side. They're probably upper teens, 20s. Peter's one of the older ones. He's probably around 30. He's probably just a little bit younger than Jesus. Matthew, like I said, is the oldest. And so John is in this mix, in the society where he's told to respect the elder, and said he's the youngest one there. He's often probably very much intimidated to be in this company of all these older men. Now, when I went back to get my master's degree at age 44, there was this wide variety of ages in my master's classes. Because coming back to be second career pastors, there were a few that were older than me, not many. There was one girl that was younger than my son, and we were all in the same class. I had several professors who were younger than me. So John, he's still considered an adult. Because at your bar mitzvah at age 13, when your first Sabbath after your 13th birthday is when your bar mitzvah, when you become a son of the law. And part of that ceremony is today you become a man. So in the eyes of the religion, that yes, even at 14, he's considered an adult. But then again, he's surrounded by these much older people. It's probably very intimidating for him. It's probably something that, you know, he's kind of nervous about speaking out in a society where age just comes into respect. There's an old joke that, with age comes wisdom. Sometimes age comes sad. But for John, he's very much part of this. And for the young John, more than any other disciples, one of the things he notices about Jesus is his courage, his boldness. None of the gospel writers ever record Jesus of being afraid of anything. But for John, this would have been especially important. He sees the boldness of Christ as he's in all these situations, as he follows him throughout his life. Mark tells us that the disciples at one time were on a boat, and they were traveling across the Sea of Galilee. And Jesus was asleep in the back of the boat on what's called the cushion. The cushion was just the stack of nets and sails and all that soft stuff. It's not what we think of as a cushion. That's what they call the cushion of the boat. So Jesus was on the cushion, and he was asleep. And a storm comes up. And it's starting to buffet the boat around and starting to swamp the boat. And the disciples, they come to Jesus and say, "Wake up, why aren't you freaking out like the rest of us? Why are you so calm?" And Jesus calms the wind, the rain, the storm ceases, and the waves calm. And he turns to them and says, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? Don't be afraid." Now, this actually had, according to Mark, the 4:41, it actually had the opposite effect. For it says, Mark writes, "They were terrified and asked each other, 'Who is this? Even the wind and the rain obey him.'" That awe, the disciples in that boat, the power that Jesus had. But Jesus was not afraid of the storm. He was not afraid of the wind. He was not afraid of the rain. Luke records another incident when they're also on the Sea of Galilee. They cross the Sea of Galilee and land at the Gerasenes, which is on the southeast corner of the Sea of Galilee. And this man, wild man, crazy man, who lives among the tombs, comes charging at him. And he's a strong man. He's broken the chains that have bound him. He's possessed by demons, many demons. His name is Legion, because there are many of them. And Legion is there, and he comes charging at the disciples just after they get off the boat. And Jesus is not afraid. Jesus turns to him and addresses him. cast those demons out of Legion into a herd of swine. Now, notice it's herd of swine. They're not Jewish. They wouldn't be raising swine if they were Jewish. It's an unclean animal. So here among foreigners, when a madman is charging at Jesus, he's still calm. He still shows no fear. Cast those demons into that herd of swine. The herd of swine goes running down the slope and into the Sea of Galilee and drown. One of the things that John notices that during most of Jesus' ministry, and starting very early in the Gospel of John, that the leadership at the temple actually wants to destroy Jesus, wants to get rid of him. They don't like what he's teaching. They don't like, they don't think he's orthodox. They don't think he's leading people the right way. And there's actually, John says, is a very clear plot to kill Jesus. Now, the other gospel writers do mention it, but not as much as John. For example, near the end of Jesus' ministry, his friend Lazarus dies. Now, at the moment, Jesus is across the Jordan River. He's at a place called Bethany beyond the Jordan. It's out of the jurisdiction of Judea. And one of the reasons he's there is because the temple leaders tried to stone him and his disciples. So he's across the river. Well, Jesus turns to his disciples and said, we're going to go back to Bethany. And the disciples are like, are you sure you want to do that? You know, they just tried to stone you. And he said, well, I need to go see Lazarus. Lazarus has fallen asleep. They go, well, he'll wake up. He goes, no, you don't understand. Lazarus is dead. And I need to go back. And what John records in verse 16, which is 11:16, which is probably Thomas's finest hour, is when Thomas, known as Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, let us also go, that we may die with him. The example of Christ that John saw is this man who had no fear at all of anything. Jesus was focused on his mission. He knew why he came. He knew everything that it entailed. And that gave him that boldness, that courage, that determination. Jesus was going to do the mission that he came, and nothing was going to stand in his way. And the reason that Jesus came was out of love for his children, for the children of first century Israel and for us here today. John writes, there is no fear in love. Perfect love drives out fear. Fear is a very powerful emotion. Fear is something that directs our behavior, and sometimes people use it to manipulate us. The threat of the harm or the threat of threats are often used to try to extort us to do something or to force us to change our behavior. In the world, we look around and we read the news, we hear the news, and can see it in our own society. Forces of hate and division are using threats of retaliation if we don't vote for the person that they deem to be right. Fear and intimidation is being used as a tool today in some of our larger cities to circumvent democracy and the rule of law. We are witnessing the same fear and the same manipulation that faced Germany in the 1930s, Russia in 1917, even the inquisitors of 12th century Spain. Fear has often been used as a means by tyrants to try to control the population. The same was true in John's time as well. During John's time, the Roman Empire had a policy called the Pax Romana, the Peace of Rome. And when this policy was instituted by Caesar Augustus in 46 BC and lasted for 200 years. So John is living almost in the middle of this policy, the Pax Romana. The Pax Romana is that if there's any insurrection, any rebellion, any revolt within the empire, it is to be squashed immediately, hard, powerfully. The whole force of the empire is to be brought down on insurrection. In 763 AD, that's exactly what happened. The Jews decided they were going to try to revolt, and it was unsuccessful. We hear the story of Masada, that last outpost where the Jews had their choice to either die or to surrender, and they committed suicide. The very punishment of crucifixion was designated specifically for insurrectionists. It was the most torturous execution the Romans could think of. And the reason that Jesus was executed by crucifixion was that the Sanhedrin persuaded Pilate that what Jesus was doing was insurrection. That's why the sign above Jesus' head said, "Jesus Christ, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews." The fear that the Roman used to keep peace in the empire for 200 years, Pax Romana, John was well familiar with it. The thing about fear is that fear is something that, an emotion that faces inward, toward us. We fear because of what's going to happen to us. We fear because of pain, of injury, of loss. We fear because we anticipate something that's going to be happening to us. Love is outward focused. Love is about other people. Love is about God. Love is about what we can do to help our neighbors. And Jesus' mission on this earth was a mission of love, a mission focused outward. Not on him, but on you and your salvation, so that you may stand in the presence of God. That's why he gave Jesus the strength to face the Gerasene demoniac. To go out and touch lepers. Leprosy it's kind of an ambiguous term as it's used in the first century. It refers to a series of skin diseases, but some of those skin diseases actually are contagious. There actually is a disease called leprosy, and it does destroy the human body. When I was growing up in El Paso, I had a disease called impetigo. It's very rare in the United States, but living in El Paso, lots of stuff comes across the border from Mexico. It's almost been eradicated in the United States, but I had impetigo. I had to be treated for it. I had to stay out. I couldn't go to the swimming pool for a week. Goddammit. John writes, "The one who fears is not yet made perfect in love." We are to strive to be people of love. We are to strive to have the heart of Christ. We are to strive to have that boldness to do what's necessary to help our neighbors, to help them and have the courage to go wherever we're sent so that we can alleviate human suffering and that we can bring them the good news of great joy that Christ died for you. That great love of Christ that even hanging on the cross with the nails in his hand already and saying, "Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do." Because he loved us, Christ came to earth, knowing exactly how it was going to end. Because he loved us, Christ went out to where people were, to where we are, and meets us. One of the fears that John talks about is the fear that we have in the presence of God, that we are just not good enough. That our salvation is not assured. That we know that we're not good enough to be called God's child. If you know what I've done, you wouldn't like me very much. And the perfect love that God has is, "I love you anyway. You are a treasure. I came so that you may have life and life abundant. I came so that you may stand in the presence of your Creator and see God face to face." The heart of pure love that Jesus had allowed him to face disease, leprosy, and diseases, and rejection. The heart of pure love that Jesus had allowed him to battle with demons. And in that 40 days of temptation, to face the very devil himself. The heart of pure love drove out the fear of challenging the powerful, of the Sanhedrin, of King Herod, of Governor Pilate. The heart of pure love drove for Jesus out the fear of death. There are a lot of things out there that try to make us afraid. But we know that God is for us. And if God is for us, who can be against us? We know that God loved us so much that he sent his only Son, that we may be washed clean of our sins and stand in his presence. To follow Christ is to keep our focus on that same love. To have the heart of Christ is to be bold as we go forth from this place, to be the people that God called us to be, to fulfill that mission, to bring the message of hope and forgiveness. There's a mural on the wall outside of Bethlehem. Bethlehem is on, actually, in the Palestinian territory, and this wall that separates Israel from Palestine. And on this wall is a mural that says, "Love wins." In the end, love wins. God never said it would be easy. He just said it would be worth it. Our hymn of reflection, "Jesus, Remember Me," is will be on the screen. You may remain seated as we sing. We see all that is going around us, and our hearts are gripped with fear. We worry about our future, we worry about our children, we worry about our country, we worry about so many things. Yet you created us. You know this about us. You came and walked among us. And in your Son, Jesus Christ, you showed us the power of love. The courage of love, the perseverance of love. Give us the heart of Christ, that we may face the world unafraid, that we may go forth and be your hands and be your feet, overcoming whatever obstacles are thrown in front of us. We thank you for the example of Jesus Christ, the boldness that you gave him, that we may also follow in his footsteps to alleviate human suffering, and so that your word may be preached from here and to the end of the earth, that message of salvation, the good news of great joy which has come to all people. Christ died for us, that we may stand into your presence. Clear away our own egos, our own pride, our own jealousies and envies, and all those other things that afflict our souls. Clear that crust of sin around our heart. Give us the perseverance to continue to grow as your disciples, to continue to walk in the way that you lead us, to hear your voice, for us to be strong. We pray for the leaders of our community, our state, and our nation. Grant them wisdom that we may live in a society of justice, that we may experience that domestic tranquility that our founders envisioned for this nation. Be with those who are fighting the diseases and caring for us, the healthcare workers, the ones that are on the front line, facing both violence and facing both disease. We pray for our military that stand between their loved homes and the chaos of those who would do us harm. We pray for those who are confused and tormented, whose minds are muddled. We pray for their focus, that your light shine upon them. We pray for those who are ill, that you may restore them to strength, make them whole in body and soul. We pray specifically for Johnny Schmidt and Alice. Johnny, he's in the hospital facing several health issues, and Alice, that because of this disease, cannot see him. We pray for miraculous healing for Johnny and God's hope and peace for him and Alice. We lift before you all those, named and unnamed, that we hold them in our hearts before you, Almighty God. Ask for your blessing upon blessing. And thank you for all that you've given us. All this we ask in the name of the great teacher, our great rabbi, your son Jesus Christ, who taught us all to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Is there anyone else today that has a special blessing, a birthday, an anniversary, or a special concern that you would like to lift before the congregation, before God's people?
Pastor?
Yes, sir.
I'd just like to give thanks for all the outpouring of contribution of help toward the dinner that we had Friday. I was really blessed by everybody that came out.
Mighty God, we thank you for the generous hearts that you've given the people in this congregation. In the luncheon that we served the high school football team this week, we thank you for the open hearts and the welcoming and the support of the community as these young men participate on the field of sportsmanship. We thank you for the willing hands and willing workers to do what it takes to make this world and this community a better place. Mighty God, we pray for Michael Decker and the health issues that he's facing. We ask your healing touch, O great physician, upon him. Be with him and comfort him. Help him with the alleviation of pain and suffering. Show him your face, that he may know your comfort, your love, and your grace. Amen. Mighty God, we pray for Lisa Stanlin as she undergoes cancer surgery, and we pray that you give skill to the doctors and guide them as they treat her. We ask for your healing touch, O great physician, that you may restore her to wholeness and to strength. We ask in your name. Amen. So need Melody, is she here?
Tuesday she will have hip replacement surgery. They're replacing the replacement.
replacing the replacement is not a good thing. Almighty God, we pray for Melody Lawrence. We pray for her healing. We pray that the surgery goes well, that the replacement works, and she's restored to strength and wholeness. We thank you for the talent that you've given her, that she leads the music in this sanctuary. We also thank you for the talent you've given Robin and the willingness to fill in and to share her talents so that we may worship you this morning. All this we ask in your name.
Feeling frustrated about the pace of their recovery. I want them to, for Cheryl to know that God is working with her, and for each of these people who are still receiving bites of healing each day, just keep them encouraged and lifted up.
Almighty God, we know that you make all things perfect in your time. Grant all those that are suffering, the patients, that you are in the process of healing them and making them whole. Grant them serenity, grant them tranquility within their souls. Grant them the blessed assurance that you are with them throughout all that they're going through. We ask in your name. Amen. Well, our closing hymn is
I Am Thine,
O Lord. Let's stand and sing. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.